Welcome to A Course in Miracles with MiraclesOne. And this is Reverend Deb Phelps. And with me today, I have Gayle Bartlett and Mari Dole. And we are going to be talking about releasing from guilt today. So, hi, ladies.
Good morning.
Good morning. Glad to be here.
Yeah. Well, so guilt.
The gift topic, that keeps right? on giving.
The gift that keeps on giving. I love that. I love it. So we are so accustomed to pain, the pain of guilt. And do we want to keep doing it, right? Do we want to keep giving that gift and receiving that gift, right, Mari?
That's right.
You know, we're going to be looking at a section today that's actually pretty long. But I think we can bring some highlights out. We can talk about some experiences today. And you, dear listener, your homework is to read the lesson or the reading today. And so we're focusing in on text chapter 13, section 10, release from guilt. That's kind of a grounding point there for us that we'll be pulling from. But let's take a thought here for ourselves about guilt and how we see that in our lives. So if I think about that, yeah, I always think about projection only because, you know, I've been around the course for so long, and that's what we do is we project, you know, the guilt outward. I should say I project my guilt outward, and it could be in different ways. It could come out in different ways, right? You know, I get angry because I'm really feeling guilty and I don't want to deal with someone else in that way. I put it out there that they're guilty, that the other person is guilty. You know, there's that piece in the course where it says, you know, would I accuse myself of this, right? You know, we could look at what's going on in the world, our government, you know, what have you. We can look at our relationships, our personal relationships. And we want to make everybody guilty because in that way, we're a victim. And, you know, well, you're guilty. You did this to me. You ruined my life, or you did whatever you did. And certainly, you know, having been married a few times, I certainly felt like, yeah, you ruined my life, you know, all of you guys. in one way or another. And this section talks about relationships too. So it talks about our relationships, and we have a relationship with everyone and everything. And, you know, here comes some psychology in, spiritual psychology, because he talks about at the beginning here of this reading about displacing guilt, the real source of guilt. And where do you guys think the real source of guilt is?
This is Mari. From the separation, we thought we did. So we thought we separated from God, which we didn't, but we thought we did, and now we're all scared to death that we're going to get zapped. And so we project that sense of guilt of what we thought we did outward. We don't want to hold on to it, so we throw it out onto other parts of the sonship or as it is other people. I'm done.
Yeah, I would say you're right on with that, because it's our own guilt. Of the separation is what's really going on. And we don't want to look at that, right? And that's why we push it out into the world even further. And we could heal it in different ways, just by the different situations, you know, just within our own lives. That's one way. And then we keep getting then to the real source of the guilt. So what about you, Gayle? What do you think?
Well, as you were talking, and Mari, thank you. We can be committed course students and still do that. What's amazing to me, and I haven't studied it as long as you and Mari have, Rev Deb, is that we can know intellectually the metaphysics of the course. We can know that guilt, you know, that holy trinity of guilt, sin, and fear. Sin, guilt, fear is what causes so much misery and heartache and angst and pain, and yet we still do it. because there is so much fear. And the last comment I want to make is when I think about myself and how often the fear of change and changing my mind is greater than the discomfort that I'm feeling. So this guilt thing, I mean, I have to share one quick example and maybe I'll elaborate. Mary read the lesson today, I am not a body, I am free. And it's just such a beautiful lesson. It can be used as a meditation, really. It's just beautiful. And Jesus, I don't mean to get off track, but Jesus encourages us to integrate that as part of our repertoire on a daily basis. And I was thinking, you know, as I was sitting there, I thought, I don't believe this. I am not a body. I'm being honest. And I thought, well, you don't have to believe it. Just do it. And I don't mean robotically or rotely, but to get in sort of a silent meditative state where I say that to myself and ask for help to integrate it. So I think this guilt is a one of the students that participates on Wednesday always calls it going down the rabbit hole. We go down the rabbit hole with guilt, and then we're afraid we can't extricate ourselves because we created such a mess. I'm done.
Down the rabbit hole we go. It's all insanity. That's all it is. And I like how you brought up the unholy triangle there, or trinity. Is that what you call it? The unholy trinity. Sin, guilt, and fear. I just love that because that's what it is, right? And that's what brings us down seemingly, because we always have a way up, up back that rabbit hole. And as we, you know, turn to this section here, once again, it's chapter 13, section 10, release from guilt. And I'm going to go to paragraph 2, and he says, insane ideas have no real relationships, for that is why they are insane. No real relationship can rest on guilt or even hold one spot of it to mar its purity. For all relationships that guilt has touched are used but to avoid the person and is italicized, and the guilt. What strange relationships you have made for this strange purpose. And you forgot that real relationships are holy and cannot be used by you at all. They are used only by the Holy Spirit, and it is that which makes them pure. If you displace your guilt upon them, the Holy Spirit cannot use them. For by preempting for your own ends what you should have given him, he cannot use it for your release. No one who would unite in any way with anyone for his individual salvation will find it in the strange relationship. I'm just going to jump down a little bit to 3 then. In any union with a brother in which you seek to lay your guilt upon him or share it with him or perceive his own, you will feel guilty. Nor will you find satisfaction and peace with him because your union with him is not real. You will see guilt in that relationship because you put it there. So you really don't escape from the guilt by placing it onto someone else or something else in any way. It's still there. You've just seemingly sidestepped it for a little while, but it's there. How can we have a real relationship when we've laid guilt in the way? It's like covering the person with mud. You know, you can't hug a person with mud all over. Well, you can, I guess, if you're into that. But I was just trying to create an image, and I guess I was going down the rabbit hole with my image making right there, trying to be helpful. Girls, save me from myself, please, in this. So avoiding the person and avoiding the guilt. I mean, how many times have we avoided someone in our lives because of that guilt we felt, right? Maybe it's something that we said we were going to do and we couldn't do. And now we run into this person and it's like we hide down the other aisle in the grocery store, you know, just to avoid them at all costs. Or we don't answer the phone, or we don't reply to an email or whatever it may be because of our own guilt. I mean, that's how it works in the world. I mean, ultimately, as we said earlier, it's really about the guilt of the separation in that. What about some thoughts that you have?
This is Mary. I think that does happen. You can also, I know that I, when I'm feeling guilty, it's often because not so much that I haven't done something, it's more that I've done something. I mean, I feel guilty because I've not been kind or I've been abrupt with someone or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so, although I do definitely project outward, I often project inward, which I think is just as harmful, projecting inward too. So yeah, that does happen, and I'm done.
Well, you know, in the paragraphs that you read, honestly, when I think about Jesus is really being no nonsense again. That any special relationship is not real, period. I mean, that's such an absolute if you think about it. He's not saying that parts of it are okay, that any special relationship that's not holy is not real. And I don't want to jump down. I want to jump down, but I don't want to because we're not there yet. Okay, I want to jump down. If you look at paragraph 5, which is just so powerful, and I underlined it with quite a bit of pressure, determine then to be not as you were. I love that. Determine. You've got to be determined to be not as you were. Use no relationship to hold you to the past, but with each one each day. Sorry about that. Be born again. A minute. I'm not sure I buy that either. A minute, even less, will be enough to free you from the past and give your mind and peace over to the atonement. When everyone is welcome to you, as you would have yourself be welcome to your Father, you will see no guilt in you, for you will have accepted the atonement which shone within you all the while you dreamed of guilt and would not look within and see it. And I think about some of the later lessons in the workbook too. I bless my brother because I bless myself, and I trust my brothers who are one with me, or whatever the title of that lesson is, as Mary and I are wrapping up part one. I think I really can't exclude anyone. He's saying that again. Is welcome to you as you would have yourself be welcome to your Father. And then paragraph 6. As long as you believe that guilt is justified in any way in anyone, whatever he may do, you will not look within where you will always find atonement. And so to yours and Mary's point, I know when I'm feeling guilty, which, you know, my indicators are anger, depression, getting in a funk, getting overwhelmed. Those are my, I mean, really, those are mine. Being extremely tired or feeling victimized. I guess that covers just about the gamut. I want to push it out. I can literally detach enough at times, not always, and watch the ego thought system take over. And I think we've talked about this in previous podcasts. What scares me at times, at least with me, I don't know if this happens to you and you, Mary, and Rev Deb, is I'll go from one heinous thought or unloving thought to another. I mean, I truly get so deeply immersed in the rabbit hole. I don't ask for the atonement. I don't, where he says, you have accepted the atonement. Where is it? You will, let's see. Whatever he may do, you will not look within. True for me. Where you will always find atonement. The end of guilt, I'm on paragraph 6, the end of guilt will never come as long as you believe there is a reason for it, for you must learn that guilt is always totally insane and has no reason. The Holy Spirit seeks not to dispel reality. If guilt were real, atonement would not be. The purpose of atonement is to dispel illusions, not to establish them as real and then forgive them. Just want to say one thing about that. How often have I misinterpreted what the atonement means by making these illusions real and then forgiving them. How often, if I get into a meditative state, do I sit there and think about all the grievances? Not that there's anything wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that process. But as opposed to saying, okay, I want to accept the atonement. I don't need at this moment because I'm jazzed or rattled about something to go through this long repertoire. All I have to do is have that little willingness to say, I am willing to accept the atonement because I don't like the way I feel, period. I'm done.
Well, that's exactly it. You know, that's that piece at the bottom of page 263, paragraph 5, where, you know, a minute, even less, will be enough to free you from the past and give your mind over to the atonement. And that's what he's always asked us, is just having that little bit of willingness, holy instant. You know, it comes in different ways and different forms in the course, how he talks about it. And whatever that relationship may be, even if it seemingly is, well, I don't know that person, that's still a relationship because you're connected to everyone here. You know, I'm going through that myself with a relationship that will be seeing this person this weekend, and it didn't get off to a very good start years ago with this relationship, and I'm, you know, it was good to review this again to take a look at, okay, well, I would want everything to be born again in a new relationship and not be held to the past. I don't, at this point, I don't particularly care for the person, but, you know, that may change, it may not change. But what I can do is change my mind. That's what it's all about, is being willing to, as he said, give my mind over to the peace and the atonement. Letting go of the undoing of fear.
This is Mary. You were talking early about the fact that, you know, sometimes he says it can be done all in a moment, and you're saying, well, no, I can't do that. Well, I think when he talks about things like that, as he does many times in the course, when he says, you can do this today, you can do this now, I think it's a matter of when I finally decide that I really want to let go of the guilt and the fear and all of the things that come with it. That is the instant that it happens. It may not happen yet because I may not be willing yet, but the time will come when I finally say, I've had enough of this. I've had enough of this pain. I've had enough of this sorrow and this fear and that whatever. And then I'm willing, and then I let it go. So since all time is one time, all time is now, it really is true. When we're willing, we can do it now. We can be released from guilt now. So I don't feel discouraged about it. I feel like, okay, I'm not willing yet, but I will be. Because after all, we're just looking back on this whole dream that we're in. It's already over. It's already been accomplished. So all I have to do is just be willing. I'm done.
Yeah, that's what it comes down to, the willingness. And that's why we emphasize that, is because without that willingness, we're going to continue down the same path. And that's why Jesus and Holy Spirit are there to help us to release from the guilt. And all we have to do is say yes. Yeah, I'm willing. I'm willing to release from the guilt. I'm willing to feel differently. You know, when you describe the different feelings that you have, Gayle, I think we all can relate to that. I know I could. You know, all the ones you were naming off, depression, this, that, the other thing. It's like, I can relate to that. I think many people can relate to that, because if we are not at peace, then there's something going on that we need assistance with. And so by recognizing, okay, I'm not at peace right now, I need help. So, and then a little bit later, he's going to give us some pieces that we can kind of put in our tool belt, spiritual tool belt, to use in that. So determine then not to be as you were And don't let any relationship hold us to the past. We are not who we are in the past. We're who we are right now. Right? And that's something to remember, particularly not only with ourselves, but whoever the other person is. Maybe they are the same. Well, no, they can't be entirely the same. They may still be a curmudgeon or whatever, you know. It's like they may still be a difficult person to deal with. But I cannot see them as what I know and what I've learned from the past. And I'm speaking for myself for this coming weekend. I don't want to see this person that way. I want to see them with new eyes. I want to see them with Christ vision and see them with love and forgiveness and having that willingness. And that's important to me. And I hope the meeting goes well. We'll see how it goes in that way. But how about some other things that we could see in this section? Once again, chapter 13, section 10, release from guilt. Well, as we get into paragraph 7, then he says, the Holy Spirit does not keep illusions in your mind to frighten you and show them to you fearfully to demonstrate what he has saved you from. That's only the ego that does that. What he has saved you from is gone. And that's why we have peace. Give no reality to guilt and see no reason for it. The Holy Spirit does what God would have him do and has always done so. He has seen separation but knows of union. He teaches healing, but he also knows of creation. He would have you see and teach as he does and through him. Yet what he knows, you do not know, though it is yours. Now it is given you to heal and teach, to make what will be now. We thought we were lost. Now we're found, right? We have it within us. You know, what he's asking of us is nothing that he didn't do, Jesus. What Jesus, right, did. And he knows that we have it within us. We just have to move away the blocks, the barriers to that, to being open to seeing ourselves, other people, as innocent, guiltless. And going down to paragraph 9 then, that first sentence, you who have been unmerciful to yourself, do not remember, you who have been unmerciful to yourself, do not remember your father's love. That's important. That's very important there. And looking without mercy upon your brothers, you do not remember how much you love him. So we're not recognizing that love. That's why we hate ourselves, and that's why we hate our brothers in that. And then he goes on, yet it is forever true. In shining peace within you is the perfect purity in which you were created. Fear not to look upon the lovely truth in you. Look through the cloud of guilt that dims your vision and look past darkness to the holy place where you will see the light.
This is Mary. Some time ago, I don't remember how long ago it was, I was listening to a spiritual podcast, and on the podcast, the presenter said something about when you stub your toe and you go, oh, Lord, you know, stop and say, mm-hmm, that's correct. Have mercy on yourself for what just happened, you know. So it's a matter of we need to give ourselves the mercy that we are craving and desiring and longing for, and also for the forgiveness that we're longing for. So that's, I think, another way that we are released from guilt is by remembering that who we are and where we are, and that we can give that mercy as well as receiving it. I'm done.
I agree with you, Mary. That was really good. Thank you. As you were reading this, Rev Deb, I was thinking about how guilt manifests in my life on a daily basis. And as both of you know, but maybe some of the listeners don't know, Bill and I own a business and I work from home. Excuse me, and it's intermittent. I do a variety of tasks that I won't bore anybody with. But I also do a lot around the house, and I won't bore you with that those particulars either. But I've thought a lot about guilt lately, not necessarily specifically to guilt in this reading, but to just my A Course in Miracles work. And I thought, whenever I feel a sense of urgency, which is often, and I go through the repertoire of what I have to do on a given day, and I'm certainly many, many times not in the moment, I think, well, guilt breeds defenses. And if my relationship with my husband and with everyone else were truly on the altar to transform to holiness, I really wouldn't feel the sense of urgency I do, which I felt my whole life. So if it's something as simple a task as doing a load of laundry or washing the floor in the kitchen or whatever, that sense of urgency is, it's almost as though I have to prove my worth. I have to prove that I've made a contribution. Why? Why? Bill would rather come home to someone who is relaxed and peaceful and in harmony, sincerely, than someone who has an attitude like I have in the past of, I had to do, even if I don't say what I've done, I have to, in my own mind, I'm thinking, boy, did I accomplish a lot. Much of which he doesn't even notice. And that's not an indictment of him. That's just the way it is. So as we talk about guilt and the special relationship and the holy relationship and the holy instant and all that, plus the readings you've read thus far on now it is given you, he's not saying after you've studied the course for 5 years, you can teach and heal. He's saying you can do that right this minute. I'm done.
That's a good point that you brought up. Because chapter 13, well, you're only about halfway through, not even the course. And he's saying, well, you can do, you can teach, heal and teach and, you know, do this now. As you said, it's not to wait until the entire book and you've done all 365 lessons and you've read the manual for teachers and all this other. No, do it now. Doing it now is how we will learn. Right? I believe at the beginning of one chapter it says, knowledge is not the goal of this course, but peace is. Right? And that's what we really want. That's what attracted us to A Course in Miracles and to the spiritual life, the path. So why not do it? You know, and as we think about what guilt feels like, and we've talked about that already, do we really want to keep holding on to that and carrying it forward in our lives? And yeah, we're going to have good days and bad days. Heck, you know, we all do. I do. You do. All of us do. But each little moment we can give over to the atonement, that's one more. One more. There's another. There's another that I can give over and realize, okay, well, my peace is more important. You know, I always go back to that. Is your peace important? Do you want peace or not? If you do, yeah, you're going to place it in the atonement bucket. That's what you're going to do. That's what's most important.
Well, let me interrupt you for 1 second before you start to read again, because paragraph 11 is really beautiful, which you already referenced. That is such an outstanding point you just made. Because so often, and I don't know if you have done this or Mary's done this or any of your listeners have done this, our listeners have done this, my emphasis has been on knowledge and understanding. Because we are so programmed as kids, as adolescents, as young adults, whether we go to college or not, whether we get advanced degrees or not, to learn. We go into a new job and we learn a new job, a new task, a new project or whatever. And the goal is learning. The goal is knowledge. And for me, when you just said that, even if I don't understand a lesson or something that we're reading right now, that doesn't matter. Because if I want to be at peace, I can be peaceful instantaneously. It doesn't matter if I understand it or not. We are so programmed in the United States and perhaps the world. I can't speak to the world. I can speak to the United States to be productive and to learn as much as we can and to become experts. And to become experts, if you think about it. I'm done.
Yeah, well, you know, you go to a job and here, read the manual. You should know what to do now. Right? You're an HR person. You know that. It's like, here it is. Drop. 3 inches thick. Well, the course is pretty much like that too, right? A couple inches thick. Here. Read it. Know it. I expect you next week to be able to handle all this. But see, that's not how the course operates. The course operates in you need to do it. You need to do exactly what he says when he says to do it. And once we do that, that's where we're successful, right? Just like anything on the job, we didn't learn it by reading the manual or by listening to somebody tell us, lecture us, you know, training videos and speakers and all that. No, we learn by doing it. And the more we do it, then, okay. So the rehearsal is what's important. Rehearsing and rehearsing. That is the practicing and practicing. That's where we get better and better at what we're doing.
To Gayle's point, I think that sometimes when you look at the course and a course in miracles, you know. So yeah, it's something you want to learn. It's like a textbook or a class. Well, that's how you first come at it. At least that's how I first came at it when I started it. But as I went along, I began to realize, no, that this is something totally different than what I've experienced in my education in the past. This is not even, I can't even put it into words because it's in a different, whole different category than learning in the intellectual sense. I mean, yes, I understand what you mean, Gayle. You can't approach it that way. And I mean, when I first started it, I think I did too. But I soon came to realize that no, this is learning of a different sort. This is putting into practice those things which will help me remember where I came from and who I am and who all of us are and who every part of creation is. And to me, that's what sets it apart from other, quote, courses, unquote. And part of that is letting go of the guilt of I have to do this and get evaluated and judged and graded and blah, 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 because that's not what we're doing. I'm done.
I love how you put that. We're not getting graded and judged, you know. There is no judgment. There is no judgment from God in this. It's, hey. Do you want to be happy or not? Do you want peace or not? You're still going to heaven because you're already there. It's just what we've made here in this world. So I want to focus on 10 and 11 before we wrap up today. So paragraph 10 tells us, release from guilt as you would be released. I think I opened with that statement. There is no other way to look within and see the light of love shining as steadily and as surely as God himself has always loved his son. And then this is in italics, and as his son loves him. There is no fear in love, for love is guiltless. You who have always loved your father can have no fear for any reason to look within and see your holiness. You cannot be as you believed you were. Your guilt is without reason because it is not in the mind of God where you are. And this is reason which the Holy Spirit would restore to you. He would remove only illusions. All else he would have you see And in Christ's vision, he would show you the perfect purity that is forever within God's Son. You cannot enter into real relationships with any of God's sons unless you love them all and equally. Bingo, flash, marquee. You know, for me, that line is just so important. Let me read that again. You cannot enter into real relationships with any of God's sons unless you love them all and equally. Love is not special. If you single out part of the sonship for your love, you are imposing guilt on all your relationships and making them unreal. That is anyone. You got to remember that. That's anyone that we do that. You know, a friend, a family member, a teacher, whatever it is. If we single anyone out, right, we're imposing guilt on all our relationships. You can love only as God loves. Seek not to love unlike him, for there is no love apart from his. Until you recognize that this is true, you will have no idea what love is like. No one who condemns a brother can see himself as guiltless and in the peace of God. If he is guiltless and in peace and sees it not, he is delusional and has not looked upon himself. To him I say. And so let's really maybe close your eyes as I'm reading this and really feel this within your own being, within your own heart. Behold the Son of God and look upon his purity and be still. In quiet, look upon his holiness and offer thanks unto his Father that no guilt has ever touched him. No illusion that you have ever held against him has touched his innocence in any way. His shining purity, wholly untouched by guilt and wholly loving, is bright within you. And just be with that for a moment. And I love the words of light, shining purity, the brightness. Because that's what we're seeing. We're seeing the trueness, the true light of who that brother is. That's our innocence. That's their innocence. So it's good to remember that when we're getting into situations, you know, experiences, meetings I have this weekend, that I can see this other person in their innocence. No matter what has been said and done before, I will go into this seeing their innocence, beholding that Son of God, looking quietly upon the holiness, releasing that guilt, because I wish to be released as well. So how about the two of you as we wrap up today?
Well, what hit me as you were reading paragraph 11, you cannot enter into real relationships with any of God's sons unless you love them all and equally. Love is not special. It's just so absolute again. I mean, it's just so, it's either God, Holy Spirit, Jesus, not pure non-dualism, or it's ego. So if I think, you know, and Mary can relate to this, and I think, Rev Deb, you can too, because you have three cats, and you know that we all love animals, whether it's a cat or a dog, the three of us. And as I was reading this yesterday in preparation for today, because I wanted to assure that I was on top of it, I was thinking about Gracie, my little dog, and I thought, I mean, she's my heart. I would do anything for this dog. I mean, she's just such an integral part of our lives. And I thought, she really, now she's an exception. Gracie is an exception. It's okay if I have a special relationship with Gracie. But, it gave me food for thought. And it made me realize that, I don't think that that's being held against me. I mean, it's pure love, unconditional love, and she's taught me so much. And maybe I've had, and I don't mean to digress too much, but maybe I've had so much fear and distrust of human beings that I've gravitated toward creatures, like little mammals, like my dogs in the past too. But the bottom line is, if I could just remember, and we could talk for hours about this, that it's we don't have to interpret that with the ego thought system. All it means is, you don't have to dissect this. You don't have to think, well, how the heck can I love my father-in-law as much as I love my husband, or as much as I love Rev Deb or Mary, because he was such a son of a gun. That's not what he's saying. You don't even have to think about that. It's just, when you get to the point where you want peace above all else, and you want, and I want you, I want all my relationships to be holy, the Holy Spirit does the work. We may not understand that sentence now, love is not special, because it kind of permeates the workbook lessons too later on. Love makes no comparisons, etc. But the bottom line is, it goes back to our discussion this morning about wanting to understand it so we can decide whether we want to do it or not. We don't have to do that. That's what, and the reason I'm so passionate about it today is because it's just dawning on me that I don't have to worry about understanding any of this. I can read it, and I can make a greater determination. And as you said, Rev Deb, and this is my last comment, we're going to make mistakes. And we're going to have good days, and we're going to have really bad days, sucky days, days we think, why am I even a course student? I can't apply this. It's too hard. I know, I thought of one more thing. How many students have you had, Rev Deb, over 25 years of teaching A Course in Miracles, and then some, where they've gone to the workbook multiple times, gotten to lesson 25 or 50? I got to 220, and I gave up. And that's when we went through it in the ministerial program. But you see, we're trying desperately to understand all this. We don't have to. I guess that's my major point today. And I think it's applicable to the reading. I hope it is. Okay, I'm done.
Of course it is. It always is. It's all about healing. How about you, Mary?
One of the things that occurred to me was that one of the reasons I was drawn to the Course so much was that oftentimes people think of God as a vengeful, judgmental, wrathful being, you know, out there to get us if we do anything at all wrong. And it's not true. What drew me to the Course was that God was loving, and not only loving, that we are all part of that love, and that everyone else is, and all creation is, and there's no reason to be afraid. I'm done.
And that's a great note to end on, because that is so true. You know, that's what it's all about, love. Loving ourselves, loving other people. And that's how we release from guilt. So we hope you enjoyed listening today and you learned a little bit more about release from guilt. And please take the time to actually read the reading too. You might gain a little bit more from the snippets that we shared today. And certainly apply it in your life, because that's how you're really going to learn it, as we've said. So be sure to see our website at www.miraclesone.org for all of our free A Course in Miracles resources and plenty of classes and such that we do offer, study groups, whatnot, that we have for you. And as always, we wish you peace. Namaste.